como un río de tigres enterrados. Y dejarme llorar horas, días, años, edades ciegas, siglos esperados. Dame el silencio, el agua, la esperanza. Dame la lucha, el hierro, los volcanes, apegados a los cuerpos como imanes, abrida mis venas y a mi boca, hablando por mis palabras y mi sangre.
No nos moverán, unidos en la lucha. No nos moverán como un árbol. We're in the río. No nos moverán. No, no nos moverán. No, no, no nos moverán como un árbol. Firme junto al río. No nos moverán. No nos moverán. No nos moverán como un árbol firme junto al río. No nos moverán. No nos moverán.
Hi everyone, thank you for tuning in. We will be starting shortly, so we're just gonna wait until 4 to see if everybody joins. Welcome. We'll start in a few minutes.
Buenas tardes. Can everyone hear me? Congratulations for signing up for our webinar today. It's on the inspirational leadership of Cesar Chavez. And today's the first day of spring, so it's a great time to be learning new things and also honoring the past. And so in 10 days, we'll have the Cesar Chavez holiday. We're going to be talking a little bit about that. But more than that, talking about your leadership and how you can learn from the lessons of Chavez's life. First of all, I want to talk to you a little bit about Lideramos, which is the organization that is sponsoring the webinars. And so welcome to our second webinar. The first one was very successful, and we're happy to have you with us. Lideramos is a new organization. It's the National Latino Leadership Alliance. And our mission is to expand, connect, and enhance the quality and the number of Latino leadership programs across America. One of the reasons we did this is 3 years ago, 11 of the top leadership programs in our country came together, and we realized that we had no organization that had leadership as its core mission. And we did a study trying to figure out what was going on in leadership in our country today for Latinos. And we published the first national Latino leadership directory, or you can get your copy on our website. And we found out that less than 0.05% of Latinos get leadership training in this country. For a community of 57 million, a community that's at the crossroads of power, a community that is ready to lead in this century. So our mission is to expand that, to create a nation of Latino leaders. To do that, we have a prestigious Lideramos Fellowship with the Center for Creative Leadership. We have a group of Latino scholars who will promote Latino leadership as a field of study. And we have launched these webinars. Stay tuned for April 18th, Mindfulness as a Leadership Practice, Learn Balance, Learn Focus, and then on May 16th, Negotiation, a Skill Every Leader Needs. We're also going to be offering the first National Latino Leadership Symposium, Leadership at the Heights. That's going to be in Denver, Colorado, October 3rd to 6th. One of our keynotes is Dr. Barry Posner, who's one of the top 100 leaders in the country, an intellectual who has written the Leadership Challenge. And we're going to learn, network, and share with programs across the country. Our goal is to build the intellectual capacity of Latino leaders. And that's why we're having Dr. Posner. We want to know everything that mainstream leaders know, and then we want to add to it the salsa, the flavor, the incredible influence of Latino leadership. So stay connected with us, info@lideramos.org, or sign up for our webinars. So let's get started. First of all, Cesar Chavez was the most influential Latino leader of the last century, and he provided a pathway that others would follow. He laid the foundation on which Latino leadership principles rest today. And he said, he had a vision. He said, there's no turning back. We will win. This was not just a struggle for equality and justice. He said it was a revolution of the mind and heart, where people would really begin to treat each other with respect and dignity, and that we would have equity in our society. So about 30 years ago, I met Dolores Huerta here in Denver. One of the things that Chavez did, which was revolutionary, was that he had a partner, and his partner was Dolores Huerta, way back in the early 60s when he started off. Dolores was kind of the brains behind the operation, doing all of the contracts with labor unions, really helping to organize things. And Chavez, of course, the inspirational leader and the strategist. So when I met Dolores, she was giving a speech and she said, you know, I want to go back to an old tradition, a Latino tradition, that when you want the spirit, the energy, the knowledge of a person that has gone before you, you call out his name and you say presente. So today, all together across this country, we can all say together, Cesar Chavez, presente. And we ask for his energy, his inspiration, and his knowledge to be given to our community. This is a tradition in our community through the Dia de los Muertos. We've just had a big hit in our community with Coco becoming the best animated film, and talking about that connection, not just to the past, but to your elders, because of course Coco was grandmother. And so this whole idea of honoring, connecting, and learning that from those that come before us is an integral part of our culture, and therefore an integral part of our leadership. And so that's me dressed up for Dia de los Muertos last year, and my community altar where I honor my parents who have come before us. And so I encourage you in your leadership to really think about who guides you. I was going to suggest that you have a little piece of paper on your side so you can write down some of these questions. I wanted to let you know that you will be receiving a copy of the webinar, so you will have that in case you miss something or come in late. Let's think about that a little bit, because Cesar Chavez is a collective ancestor of all of ours who have come before us. But all of us have people who we honor, who taught us things. What did we learn from them? Who gave us qualities that we want to emulate. And so again, Chavez's leadership is based on our cultural foundation. It's based on us honoring those that came before us. It's based on us never forgetting the strength, the power, the vision of those that came before us. So stop for a moment and just jot down, because these are homework assignments. I hope these will be things that you can do later that will deepen and enrich your leadership presence. So connect to an ancestor, your parents or someone who came before you, a special aunt that you had, a mentor. And what did you learn from them? And what are the qualities you want to emulate today? Okay, so keep that little piece of paper handy, and this will be something we'll be working with. And I hope after the webinar, this will give you some deep things to think about and different ways to connect to the past and to your leadership. So one of the things that the farm workers did, and you can see them on the picture on the left, is that they always started their meetings, which we are doing today, with the farm workers' prayer. It was written by Chavez in order to bring people together and to help them understand the values. Now, leadership today is value driven. People want to know what you stand for. What are your values? What guides your leadership? So let's stop for a moment and take a deep breath. Let us put our feet on the ground and relax, and really in a receptive way, listen to the words of Cesar Chavez, who said that this should be a guide for your leadership. So first he prayed that he would understand the suffering of the most miserable so that he would know his people's plight. He asked to be free to pray for others and to be able to see that the spirit was in every person. He asked to take responsibility for his life so that he could be free to do what he needed to do. Cesar asked for the courage to serve others and believed that in service, there is true life. Then he asked for honesty and patience so that he could be effective working with others. And finally, bringing forth song and celebration so the spirit will be alive among us. So let's stop for a minute and just ponder these words that they would use to bring inspiration and light into their work. If you know your people, if you know your people, what their values are, you know, you've walked in their moccasins, you've made those connections, then certainly you can be a better leader. The idea of understanding that every person has a spirit, every person should be respected, every person has something to contribute, to pray that we're given that understanding. That we take responsibility. Leadership is about this responsibility that we take for our own lives so that we can become models for others, so that we can help others find their leadership capacity. To have courage. Of course, leaders always need courage to do what is right, to be able to speak up, to finish the task. Courage. And then, of course, the idea of service that we'll be speaking about, the servant leadership that Chavez brought forward, and the idea for him that in service there was life. And then, of course, honesty, which we will talk about when we talk about the values that Latinos bring to leadership and that Cesar emulated. Honesty and patience, because leadership takes time. It's paso a paso and poco a poco, so that paciencia that leaders have to have. And then, of course, we must celebrate. We must always acknowledge people's accomplishments, acknowledge the team, acknowledge those that we work with, and allow that spirit, that team spirit, that community spirit, that Latino spirit, to be alive among us. So that's how Cesar Chavez would start his meetings. And so I hope there's a deepening in yourself to understand that he was both a leader in many, many different capacities. He was a political leader. He was a people leader, leading people. He was a community leader that built community. He was a spiritual leader, and he was a servant leader. So when he said, allow me, free me to pray for others so that he could see the goodness in each person, that's really a leadership trait, that high level of leadership. Leaders are able to see within other people those qualities sometimes that they can't even see themselves. We bring out the best in people. We bring out that goodness. So I met Cesar Chavez twice in my life. And the first time I met him, he was wearing a white shirt like this. And when he came out, it was the 70s, and I was in my 30s, a young leader. I looked at him and I thought, oh my God, he looks India from India, and he looks Native American, he looks Latino, he could pass for Italian. He had that sense of universality that leaders get when they've transcended their culture, when they have that feeling that they're here to lead all people, to make society better for everyone. And so Chavez embodied that sense of leadership that says, I understand, yes, I'm Latino, but I understand the humanity of all people. And I am here as a leader to reinforce, to nurture, and to draw that out. Now, I must also say that because if you read the life of Chavez and what he was able to accomplish way back in the 60s, and we're going to talk a little bit about the time in which he led, and the times in which you lead. Because as I say in my book, The Power of Latino Leadership, our leadership has grown out of the nonprofit sector, out of the educational sector, out of the government sector. Certainly Chavez was an activist leader, and that leadership has changed over time. And yet the lessons, the relentless work that our leaders did to bring us to where we are things that we can learn from today. So leadership is always based on the individual. In the Latino community, we call that personalismo. And I want to take a moment to look at the early influences of Cesar Chavez's life that shaped him as a leader. And then I'm going to share a little bit about my early life that shaped my leadership path. And then I'm going to give you an opportunity again to do a little reflection and think about your own life and how that has prepared you for leadership. So there's a picture of Chavez getting ready for his early communion. Spirituality was always very important to him. He was actually born in 1924. And when he started school, much like your grandparents or your parents, people called him a dirty Mexican. Now, you have to realize that in this time, Latinos were not an identified group. We still went by our country of origins. They made fun of his accents. And children were punished for speaking Spanish at that time. And so many Latinos, Chicanos, Mexicanos lost their language. Then on August 37th, his family, unable to pay back taxes, Arizona took their land from them and they became landless and went to live with his grandmother. This is not something that just happened to the Chavezes. If you look at the early land grants and you look at the Southwest, many Mexicanos, people of Spanish descent, et cetera, lost their land because as taxes came in, they had been more of a collaborative community-based society. They didn't have the money to pay for their land and lost it. So for 10 years then, the family were farm workers moving from farm to farm in California. But Cesar saw the conditions he would work to change, the corrupt labor contracts, the wretched migrant camps, the meager wages for backbreaking work, and the discrimination and racism that these workers had to endure. One winter, his family actually lived in a tent. And I think as we talk about these things, when he says, understand the plight of people, that we today as Latinos still have people that are underrepresented, that are still doing this kind of work. And of course, it's a call to our leadership. So then when his father was in a car accident, and here he is in 1942. He quits school in the eighth grade, begins to work in the fields with his brother and sister. They're thinning lettuce, sugar beets, and onions. And Cesar was using the short-handed hoe, which was short. When you read about the work, it was backbreaking, and he later worked to eliminate that instrument and to outlaw it for future workers. He saw his father in unions. There wasn't a Latino union at the time, just the national farm workers. But as he participated in strikes and union activities, he began to learn how to organize farm workers and how difficult that would be. And then finally, during World War II, he joined the Navy and saw the discrimination that extended not just to Latinos, but Blacks, Filipinos, who were given the lowest jobs. And I have to stop here again and say that World War II was an important moment for Latinos. It was the first time that we joined the military, we came back, we had the GI Bill, we were able to buy homes with that, we were able to go to college. So your grandfathers and your fathers were able to become middle class because of World War II. And so Chavez had that experience at the time. And as you know, an overwhelming number of Latinos have served our country. So your early life, how did it prepare you to be a leader? This is a picture of myself. I'm the little girl in the corner with my mother, Maria, and six of her eight children as we were about to board a banana boat in Nicaragua come to the land of opportunity, to come to America. My father had come a few months earlier, a few years earlier, with my sister, my two older sisters, to earn money to bring his familia to the United States. And we're going to see as we progress how important immigration has been in building the Latino community and in expanding our numbers. So my mother, a very humble woman with a fifth grade education, she goes to the parish priest and she says, I can cook, I can clean, puedo cocinar, puedo limpiar, puedo cuidar niños. And she begged him for a job. She said, I came here so my children could get educated. I didn't understand it then, but my mother and the immigrants that have come here, your parents, your grandparents, they gave up everything. They gave up their culture, their home. They gave up their family. They gave up the respect they had back home. They gave up their language, and they come to a strange country with the whole idea, with the whole strategic vision of making life better for their children. I did not know it then, but my mother was such an incredible leader that she had that vision, that she had that determination, that she would go on to work on Sundays in the church nursery, working constantly so her children could have a better life, and we did because of that. But her ability to have that vision, to sacrifice her life so that her children could have a better life, is the very essence of leadership. But more than that, she was strategic. She got us into good schools. She took me to a high school where I could get a scholarship and get a good high school education. And so all of her children ended up having degrees, having better lives because of her vision, that of my father's. One of my older sister, Rosemary, back to World War II, came at the same time because my family, she immigrated here about 42, and she joined the Waves and served our country. And because she was able to speak Spanish, they sent her to Naval Intelligence. She lived in Miami. She translated some of the documents from Argentina. She helped and was flown to Buenos Aires to help bring in the submarines. And she won a medal from President Truman for her dedication to our country. This is who we are as a people. Latinos have more Medal of Honors than any other community. We have stood up. We have fought for our country. And those early experiences prepared me to be a leader. And so have your early experiences prepared you to be one. You know, I always like to say that because we have come from the working class and 60% of Latinos are still in the working class, we have that ability to work hard, to be strategic, to set goals, and to improve not only our lives, but that of our families. So let's take a minute for you to think about your own identity and values. Your early life is the soul from which your leadership grows, just like Chavez was prepared for leadership through his work in the fields, through what he saw as a child, and through the discrimination that he felt for himself and others. As you reflect on your early life, what circumstances or events are significant? And surely, when we talk about the immigrant experience, when we talk about the Latino experience, the idea that we're a community that's advancing, we're a community that is working together in order to help our immigrants, in order to educate our children. What are some of the early life experiences that you had that you look back today and say, that prepared me for leadership? A scholarship you had, a counselor that helped you, an ability to work with other communities because you grew up in a more multicultural neighborhood. And then think of the values we talked about in the beginning, about courage, about compassion to see the plights of others, about the ability to really focus on what it is you want to do as a leader, to have that sense of purpose, your values, your generosity that comes from the mi casa, su casa, our ability to help one another. Which values really drive your leadership today that have come out of your early life? And last, how does this identity, these values influence and drive your leadership today? You may be known as someone who mentors people or grows people. You may be known as a leader that is very generous with your time, your abilities, your skills. You may be known as a leader that really respects people or that appreciates them and says thank you. You may be known as a leader that shares, just like your family did, because we work together in order to advance. So these are some things for you to take back with you and think about them. Just as Travis's life and my life influenced my leadership, so did yours. So we do need to understand a little bit of the past if we're going to be leaders for the times today. And I think one of the reasons Chavez had such a movement to help farm workers, because as we know, a third of the United States was Mexico. And so California and Arizona, the places where he grew up, these were places with large Mexican populations. But at the same time, place where there was much discrimination against Mexican-American people. I put up this charro on the side here on the horse because I want you to understand that this one-third of the United States, the Spanish were here 100 years before the Anglo settlers. They were in Florida. They went all the way up to Oregon, into the San Juan Islands and up to Alaska. And there were villages, there were squares, you know, like, what do you call those? The village square. I'll think of it in a minute. There were ranches, there were miners, there were schools, there were missions. And so all of these things were already here before the Anglo settlers came. And when the war was over, the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo said that on these lands, for the rest of history, that people would have dual citizenship and could speak two languages. Of course, we know what happened with that treaty. Native Americans will tell you that many times the treaties are not honored. And so, of course, New Mexico was the only state that honored that, where it's called the land of enchantment, where three cultures live, and they do their government in both English and Spanish. And so we need to work on that, but I have some good news on this as we move forward. So what happened because of the Mexican-American War, which sets the stage, again, a leader has to be very, very right for the times in which they lead. So we're looking at the times in which Cesar Chavez would lead. We have on the right, LULAC, 1922. That was actually a sindicato. It was a union. It was to help the working class. It was to look at the conditions that workers lived and worked in. We also have in 1951, a class apart, which was the first time Latinos went to the Supreme Court. They were being discriminated against. And in the case Hernandez versus Texas, he was being tried by an all-white jury. The Supreme Court, and this set a precedence for Latino leadership, because the way the money was earned in order to do this Supreme Court case was by selling burritos, by people giving pesos and dollars and quarters, and we won. We were then known as a class apart. In this time, if you look in the 20s, there were signs, no Mexican, no dogs. And then we had the American GI Forum as well that was formed. And that was formed because of in 1948, because white veterans couldn't be buried alongside with Anglo veterans. So this is kind of the times in which Chavez comes into leadership. And so his leadership, because of these times, was very much a si se puede leadership. It was a leadership in the fields. You'll see some of the walkouts that happened. But it was a time that Latinos were beginning to assert their political power. They were beginning to have an identity. Things like Mecha, which is the Movimiento de Aztlán Estudiantil Chicanx. In 1968, we have enough Latinos in college now that we have our first Latino college organization. But the leadership that Cesar had to respond to these times. And these were times of conflict. These were times when civil rights was being tried, and he would bring that movement forward.
Juana, we have a question.
Yes, great.
Okay, so Rick is asking, how can Latinos best lead now during this divisive time in American history?
That's a great question, and we were going to get to a little bit of that. I think part of it, of course, is what I'm doing today. I'm going over some history, but you know, you have to know your past, you have to learn from the past, and you have to gain strength from the past. If we could do what we did under those trying circumstances, if Cesar Chavez, I mean, most of us that are listening today, we have a salary, you know, we might even be paid for watching the webinar. Cesar Chavez, these workers had to take time out of the fields to go and try to get a living wage. And so we can take strength from them. We can take courage from them. We can learn from them. And we can understand that the fight is not over. We're going to go there now because we have DACA, we have immigration, we have the wall. And so there's some things that Latinos are facing today. And for those of you that are corporate leaders, I know many of you are corporate leaders that are listening. These are still things that we can take into our organizations. The idea of si se puede, yes, we can. You know, the idea that we can be innovative, the idea that we can look and support innovation and change. The fact that we can stand up for equity and diversity, you know, that we can form affinity groups and have Latinos have a voice, that we can reaffirm our values of generosity and cooperation and working together within our organization. So there's lots of lessons here. And as we move forward a little bit more, we'll talk about how those lessons are needed today. But just take a quick look. I think most of you had time to read this. And all I want you to get from this is that, as we know, immigration has been a revolving door. In the 1940s, when it was wartime, we had the Bracero program. So we had 350,000 immigrants coming to the United States legally under the Bracero program. And then, of course, then we don't need them. Operation Wetback in 1954. 3.8 million people of Mexican descent were deported. So we have to remember that these things are not new. These things are happening today. Immigration is important to our community as leaders. We're going to see in a minute how that's so important, because our growth in the last century, 40 to 50% was immigration. That means we have to integrate people into our community, help them learn English. We need to learn from their immigrant experience. And then today, DACA, here we are with the Dream Act. Again, this idea, even though a third of the United States was Mexico, even though we're here to make a contribution, even though studies show that Latino immigrants give more than they take, we are still facing the kind of discrimination that many had in the 60s and earlier. So today, you as leaders, we're diversity now. Cesar Chavez led mainly a Mexican-American group. Today, we still have a predominance of Mexican-Americans in our community because hey, history, a third of the United States was Mexico. They're our neighbors. But look at this, 15% of us now come from Central and South America. So that means Honduras, Nicaragua, El Salvador. In fact, Salvadorians, this is the 2010 census, first time El Salvadorians and Dominicans came. So you as a leader today, yes, we take from Chavez his identity. We take from him the idea that it's important to know who you are. But we have a much broader scope in which we lead. And today we are called to lead a multiracial, multicultural, multinational community. And here's our national community, by the way. I just put that up there so that for those of you that haven't seen these kind of presentations, we are global. And part of the work that I do in leadership is that we have an immigrant spirit and a global vision. You can see that because of our history and our culture, Latinos are connected to our global village. And if you talk about our hemisphere, we're the connection between North, South, Central, and South America. So one thing that for folks that haven't really clicked onto this, Chavez worked when we weren't even a minority. We weren't even declared a minority till 1977. And the first time we were put in the census was 1980. We're a very young community. We're still in the identity formation age. And because of immigration, because of our diversity, this work of bringing the community together is really one of the main jobs of Latino leaders. Then you can see that Latino was added to the census in 2000. But interestingly enough, the Pew study shows that 51% of Latinos still identify with their country of origin. And that's good. In a multicultural, multiracial society, we can say we're Puerto Rican and we're American. We're Cubanos and we're American. We're Dominican and we're American. You know, we have the capacity to be much more than that of which we are today. And so Hispanic identity, you know, one way Latinos have their identity is that we have to check that box on the census, because that's the only way our community is counted, and that's the way we're really going to have more power in the United States in the future. So what did Cesar Chavez do? Number one, he reshaped the American labor movement. He brought minorities, people of color, farm workers into the labor union movement. And interestingly, and I want to recommend both the Chavez movie and the movie Dolores, because that really gives you an idea of these two Hispanic icons. They were the ones, really, Latinos were the ones, Mexicans were the one that instituted door-to-door outreach and community organizing. They built the rank and file, which today is a common democratic practice. It's a common practice between the political parties and for those of us that organize, whether it's the environments or education. He also built coalitions. Remember, here's Chavez with the clergy, with the Black community, with the white power structure. You see him there with Robert Kennedy and with Anglo leaders on the bottom of the page. Fred Ross was one of his mentors, who was a community organizer. And so he brought this coalition of people together. That's where you get his universality. And that's the kind of leaders we need to be, inclusive and reaching out. He ignited a Latino political power base. So we might say he was Mexican-American, yes, but we were looking at Latinos growing out of that movement and beginning to have a power base. Now, this is very interesting. All of us know about the environment today, but we're going to look a little closer that it was the farm workers who first brought environmental justice to the foreground. And then he was a spiritual leader. He talked about social activism, spiritual responsibility, that it is our responsibility as spiritual people to be activists, to look at humanity and what we can do to elevate their status. And finally, he promoted peace and nonviolence. So I think we can be proud as we look at Cesar Chavez as the leader of the last century and the things he brought forward. So here's this thing on the environment. This is the last words Cesar Chavez said in public. He said, farm workers are society's canaries who live in the area of grapevines and are constantly exposed to cancer, birth deformities, miscarriages, steroids, respiratory difficulties, and death. But he says, you find toxic substances in the fields, in the streets, in the soil, in air, in water, in playgrounds. And these poisons are killing our children. So the thing about Chavez is he started off as a farm worker, then he organized farm workers, but then he cast his nets very, very wide. And by the early 1980s, the Farm Workers Union were warning us about the ecological dangers of chemicals and the over-corporatization of farming, where the soil would be used and the food in our table would not be nourishing, and in fact, poisoning America's children. So he became a leader for all people. So let's talk a little bit about some leadership principles as we get into the second part of our time together. And thank you all again for joining us. You know, leaders are lifelong learners. Leaders are constantly sharpening the saw. That's one of the habits of highly effective people, that you're constantly learning and looking for better ways to lead. We talked about the first one already, that we have a global vision as Latinos. I do programs now where I'll have people from 10 or 11 countries that are Latinos. And we have that immigrant can-do spirit, right? That idea of seeking something better, of looking for opportunity and believing that we can do it. So the principles we're going to talk about that Latinos use and that Cesar Chavez used in order to build his movement is, first of all, juntos, leadership by the many, trying to create as much leadership as we can, whether we're seeding leadership in our affinity group, whether we're seeding leadership in our team or our organization, in our communities, in our churches. We're trying to get as many people to assume and to believe that they too have leadership capacity. Then si se puede, we've been talking about this, that his type of leadership was social activism and coalition leadership, bringing people together. But si se puede is a yes, we can form of leadership. And that's unstoppable when you believe that we can do it. And then these other two are really important because, you know, leadership is hard work for people. So how do you celebrate their leadership? Gozar la vida, celebrate life. And it's important after everything a team accomplishes, every time you finish a project, every time you have a milestone, that we celebrate that, because that's how we prepare ourselves for the next one and get strength and joy that we need to continue. And then finally, the faith and hope that has been present in our community, the idea that Latinos have a deep faith and esperanza. We're going to see that Latinos are actually more optimistic than other people because of that deep faith and hope we have. So before you think about leadership, though, I just want to throw these two things in about preparing for leadership. Latinos have a thing called personalismo, and that means that we treat everybody with respect and courtesy. You know, that warm and friendly and personal ways. I wish I could give all of you an abrazo, you know, and see you and connect in that way, because we take an active interest in each of our lives. And, you know, that sense of relationship and people is the heart of the Latino culture. So personalismo has become the type of leader who earns respect and trust. Cesar was respected because he was honest, because he was loyal, because he centered on others, because he was community minded. That type of person in our community is called somebody de confianza, somebody that you can trust. And it's a high compliment to be called someone de confianza. And so that's real important. I like to think of it this way. You know, in our language, we have soy and estoy. Estoy is right now. Soy is who we are. So tap into the soy of your being. Become a, you know, leadership is about soy. And let's look at what other people have said about that. Hold on. We're going to do this first. Let's look at how, again, how Chavez prepared for leadership. His first life instilled him with a sense of justice and compassion. He experienced working in the fields. He attends meetings. These are all skills he's building. And he begins to read St. Francis of Assisi and Gandhi. Although he was not a formally educated man, he read, he studied, he learned. And then he joined a community serving organization, it was called. He joined that at 25 years old, and he gets trained as a community organizer. He goes out and he does voter registration. He goes out, he works for a minimum wage for people. He goes out and he works for different kinds of labor union contracts. And from there, he became a leader. So back to what we were talking about in the previous slide about personalismo and preparing to lead. A A great quote in leadership from Frances Hesselbein, one of my mentors, who's a thought leader and past president of U.S. Girl Scouts. She says, leadership is how to be, not how to do it. And of course, in particularly in the dominant culture, we're running around doing, doing, doing. We're all so busy. And yet you have to take the time to say, wait a minute, leadership is how to be. Who am I? Why do I want to be a leader? What drives me? And then Peter Block, the author of Stewardship, says, leadership is a commitment to work on yourself first. We're constantly sharpening that saw. We're doing webinars. We're learning more. We're reflecting. We're asking for feedback. So what is your continuing development plan for your leadership growth? That would be a question I would jot down in your little notes that you're taking to expand this and really have it work. By the way, this webinar starts when you start doing some of this work and really looking at some of the things you learned and how you can put them into practice, because leadership is an art. Second of all, what steps have you taken to prepare yourself to be a leader? Let's celebrate those. And also looking back on that, you can look at the paso a paso steps and where you are today. You might even be able to say, oh, wow, I'd forgotten. But I really have, since I was a young child, wanted to work with people. I've had that sense of wanting to be someone who made a contribution. And what are you learning today that can help you become a more connected and effective Latino leader? And I put the word connected because I think there is that idea that we need to start connecting with each other and building these networks of leaders. So I wanted to tell you a story over on the right. That's Joaquin and Julian Castro with their mother, Rosie. And I met those two when they were like 8 years old, because Rosie was a graduate of the National Hispana Leadership Institute when I was president of the organization. And these two come trotting into Washington, D.C. for the graduation. Well, I knew their mother well. She was a community organizer. She's an educator. She went on to be the first in her family to get a degree. Her grandmother came over as a maid from Mexico and worked. And so she had that sense of si se puede, we're going to lift our family up. And her children were taken to be part of the community, to work in the community from a very young age. And that kind of preparation that they had has been quite important in their success, with Joaquin now serving in the Congress, Julian being the youngest Latino to ever, or the youngest person, not Latino, to ever be elected mayor of a major city when he was mayor of San Antonio. And so this early life is important, because as we go back, we will see that for our mother, we learned, oh, I gotta take the opportunities that this country's given me to get educated. From my mother, I learned, oh, I went to community meetings, or I went to church, I learned these values. So what are those things you have learned, and how have they prepared you? So I hope you'll take time in the future to really be thinking about having a plan for your development, honoring and reflecting on the steps you've taken in the past. And every day when you learn something, how can that make you a better leader? So I'm going to go a little faster now because I realize we have to end up at 4. I just want you to know that our leadership and Cesar Chavez's leadership has been connected to our values. Latinos are a we culture. People come first, familia, community, serving others. And that's very powerful, because leadership today is collaborative, is team-oriented, is participatory. And we have a head start on that. We know how to do that. Cesar came from a huge family. I came from a family of 8. Just that taught me how to get along and work with others. So this generosity of giving time that comes out of the mi casa es su casa, the respeto that he showed for all people, and the honesty. You're a mujer or hombre de palabra, your word is law. Really quickly, some of our values. Hágalo con orgullo, con gusto. Always do the best you can, add that passion, that gusto. Camarón que se duerme, se lo lleva el corriente. That means to be proactive, have that si se puede spirit, that we're not going to sit around in the corriente. We're going to figure out what we need to do successful. We're going to take those steps. We're going to be proactive, which is the number one habit of highly effective people. Los que no trabajan no comen means everybody does their part. Latinos are a collaborative culture, a we culture. And we bring that sense to our organizations, that working together is how we accomplish our goals. And cada cabeza es un mundo, and that is the respect. Show me how I can respect every person. Who are they? What are their early experiences? What are their goals? How can I help them become a more effective leader? Again, échale agua al caldo, that's our resourcefulness, our idea that we do have enough to go around, that we can learn from everything. No hay mal que por bien no venga. Aunque la monja se viste en seda, monja se queda. And this is about the authenticity, back to personalismo. Who are you? You know, what do you stand for? What are your values? People need to know that. How can they relate to you as a leader if they don't know who you are? And then, of course, paso a paso. That's if we can look back in our community for 500 years, paso a paso has brought us to where we are today. Okay, so how do your cultural values impact your leadership? What are the cultural gifts and assets you bring to leadership? And maybe there's some things about the Latino culture that may not fit. For example, you know, we're trained to be so polite, nice, and generous, and sometimes we just got to learn to say no. That's what I'm working on. What else do you need to know to be a Latino leader? So I'm going to give you a tip here. On April 15th, you can learn mindfulness, learn to have balance, learn to, you know, we have so much on our plate, learn to prioritize. And then on May 16th, something Latinos need to know. We're just too nice. We need to negotiate. We need to know how to give and take. We need to know how to ask for what we need. And we won't get into why we're not so good at these things, but this is something that we can add to our toolbox. And the way I look at it, you know, Latinos have it going on. We know mainstream leadership. We've been to the mainstream universities, and now we bring our values, we bring our assets, we bring our culture. We learn what we need to know, and you're getting just a better leader. So Chavez was a servant leader. He claimed, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how he transformed servant leadership. The servant leader begins with the natural feeling that one wants to serve. And in our society, they say people are motivated by self-interest, that people are competitive, that people, you know, want to be in charge. And servant leaders say, no, we want to serve people. That doesn't mean we are not empowered. That doesn't mean we don't do what we need to do. Because the test, the test of the servant leader is, are people's highest priority needs being served? And that's a picture of me when I worked at Mikasa. That's our first home. Mikasa was started in the 70s by 7 Latinas. And today, Mikasa is the largest Hispanic serving organization in the state of Colorado. Why? Because we went door to door asking Latinas in the barrio, what is it we can do to empower you? What is it we can do to help your life, make your life better? What is it we can do in our center? And, you know, it was things like English as a second language, employment opportunities, finishing our GED, things that we probably knew. But until you ask your people, what is it you need to be more effective? How can I be a better leader? And until you really reflect on the highest priority needs of the people that you serve, you really can't understand what you need to do to make them more effective. Now, Chavez took servant leader, which came out of Robert Greenleaf's work in the 1970s, and he said, no, you don't just serve people, you serve your community. And being of service is not enough, you must become a servant of people. And many times that idea of servant is not, doesn't fit well with people that have had to do a lot of service work, etc. But the idea is that instead of leaders being in charge and telling people what to do, instead of leaders saying, this is the way we're going and this is what we have to do, the servant leader really asks first and then decides what it is that they have to do. So here's the Brown Berets, but you'll see what they wanted to do: education, cultural awareness, self-determination, and nonviolence. So again, in your little reflection book, think of a time when you made the decision to serve first. Servant leadership is an empowerment form of leadership because you're supposed to help people to be more, to be leaders themselves, to be empowered, to be more autonomous, to learn to serve others, to understand that they too are leaders, to help bring out their leadership qualities. So think of a time when you served, when your cup runneth over, when you knew that you could do something for someone else. And that's when we really feel the most empowered. How did this bring you to aspire to lead? and what was the impact on the people you served? And so I can say that when I was at Mi Casa, the seven women that started it, we had some volunteers. We were in the basement of a church to start. And once we were getting moving, the seven of us said, well, what are we going to do now? And I thought, yeah, what are we going to do now? And then all of a sudden I realized that they're looking at me. And I thought, oh, maybe it's me. And I thought, yes, I'll do this. I'll make a decision to serve. Because I made that decision, then I became a leader. That's how I became a leader. And then the impact, of course, was that we have built an incredible organization over the decades. People have come and we have empowered not only Latinas, because now we reach out, serve the community and families. So once you make that decision to serve, then you say, yes, I'll lead. And how can I do that? So let's move to the next thing is paso a paso and leadership by the many. And this is a quote by the great leader Raul Seguere. For my book, The Power of Latino Leadership, by the way, I interviewed many of our leaders that have built our leadership capacity in the last century. And he's talking about strategy. He says, you know, you do have a long-term vision. You have a huge vision. You think big. That's what leaders do. But you've got to motivate people. And that means paso a paso. That means building sequential steps. That means keeping people moving and motivated. And when you do that, little by little, paso a paso, you have to break it down into action planning and the different things you want to accomplish. And as you do that, and as you celebrate that, then people, wow, we did that. We can do more now. Their vision of what they can accomplish becomes wider and more expansive. This is a quote by Arturo Vargas, someone else I interviewed for my book, who is now the director of the National Association of Latino Elected and Political Officials. And he says, this is our vision now. And you can see it in Chavez because he left many leaders to follow and do his work. He said, if people are waiting for the great brown hope, give it up. It ain't gonna happen. Instead, we have thousands and thousands of leaders working collectively every day throughout our communities. That's the new model of Latino leadership. And it's inclusive leadership. So Latinos, all of us that are online today, we're working in our communities. We're working in our organizations every single day. I get the opportunity to teach across the country. I was just in Chicago. There, I worked with 24 of our leaders who are working every day to make our communities better. I just came back from Rochester, New York. 40 years, Latinos there have been meeting through United Way. We can go across the country, down into Miami, to Las Vegas, to Los Angeles, several leadership programs we have found in Portland. So we are building a nation of leaders, inclusive leadership. Everyone's welcome to the table. So one thing about Latinos that we can see that they have kept the spirit of Cesar Chavez alive is that, you know, we could have said, you know, the immigrants, they need to take care of this business. We had to do it. My family had to do it. Your family had to do it. But no, Latinos said, no, these are our people. We see each other as extended family. Vargas says, I see immigrants as my parents. I want to give them respect. The fact that Latinos are standing up for immigration, standing up for DACA, this is the tradition of Cesar Chavez. This is Hilda Solis, who is now a commissioner in the Los Angeles County. That's almost like being president of a country. And she's talking about her father, who went in. Hilda is Mexican and Guatemalan and Nicaraguan. And her father went in and organized the immigrants because they couldn't use the bathroom. And he said, I'm not going to sit here quietly. I'm going to go and I'm going to change this. I'm going to make a difference. What is it that you need to make a difference in your organization? And how can you find the courage and patience to do that? One other thing about Latino leadership that came from Chavez and also has been our way of leading is that we lead through coalitions and through partnerships. We build partnerships. It's not about our numbers. It's about leveraging our numbers. It's about empowering our community. It's about building organizations that are strong across the country. And so we do that kind of coalition leadership. And I would encourage you to join organizations. Hispanica is the Hispanic MBA Association. to join us, SAID, which is the Hispanic Association on Corporate Responsibility, to work with NCLR, which is now Unidos Us, because it is in that collective power that we will make these changes. So finally, let's look at Gozar la Vida. Chavez, bring forth song and celebration so the spirit will be alive among us. They marched singing De Colores. They marched with a statue of Our Lady of Guadalupe in front of them. And they marched singing De Colores and singing songs, We Shall Overcome. And when Chavez said, when he was asked, well, how do you put together activism and spiritual responsibility? He said, oh, it's easy. We're going to pray a lot and we're going to pick it a lot. And so Chavez is saying, you've got to have that spiritual base. You have to have something, whether it's your values, your culture, what is it that centers you that you can, that was going to make you a better person? You pray a lot, you pick it a lot. So we know this Gracias a la Vida, a great song by Violeta Parra. Thanks be to life. Estamos en las manos de Dios. Our tradition has always been to be thankful for what we have. And that's the reason that Latinos are more optimistic. A study by the New York Times said that 75% of Latinos believe that their opportunity was better to succeed than their parents. And only 56% of Anglos believe that. 64% of immigrants believed that their life would be better. It was, and they believed, 83% of them believed the life for their children would be better. Yep, Latinos are moving up. Adelante. You know, I say my future's so bright, I got to wear shades. From where I came from, things are really good. Now I can use these things to enhance my leadership and to move that forward. So Chavez ended up being someone who fasted and prayed. And when I went to California to see the replica of the place where he fasted, it was just a small bed, and he would sit there and make origami birds as he fasted. And he did three fasts, one for 20 some days, all of them for 20 some days. And he would do that in the tradition of Gandhi. He did one in 68, in 72, and in 81. And he said he's fasting because he wants to pray for the people to have moral authority. And he wanted to pray for us, the activists, so that we would know what is right. He wanted to pray for the persistence, the hard work, the faith, and sacrifice, so that we would be dedicated to justice and to nonviolence. Cesar Estrada Chavez died at the age of 66. In the Asian community, they believe that the powerful wings of the crane would carry souls to paradise and would bring people to the higher levels of spiritual enlightenment, which is what I believe happened to Cesar Chavez. Chavez's holiday will be celebrated March 31st. Senator Barack Obama wanted this to be a national holiday. The states of Arizona, California, Colorado, Michigan, Nevada, New Mexico, Texas, Utah, and Wisconsin all have special days to celebrate and take time on the 31st to honor this great American. And this is one thing you can do. It is a national day of service. You can work to make sure that the Latino tradition set by Cesar Chavez is honored and becomes a national day across America. Chavez brought us pride in who we are. They would say not only presente, but they would say viva, viva la huelga, viva Cesar Chavez, viva Latino leadership. Viva Dolores Huerta. So I'm going to put on the song now, De Colores, which is the song that the farm workers used while they marched. Hold on, everyone. And I want to see if there's any questions. Those of you that are leaving, that's great. Thank you so much for being with us. I hope this has inspired you about Cesar Chavez and has also given you some leadership ideas of how you too can bring this leadership forward. So here's De Colores. Gracias, gracias. And I'm gonna see if there's any questions.
No questions.
I hope you'll join me. De colores, de colores se visten los campos en la primavera. De colores son los pajarritos que vienen de afuera. De colores es el arco iris que vemos lucir. Y por eso los grandes amores de muchos colores me gustan a mí. Y por eso los grandes amores, muchos colores me gustan a mí. Thank you all so much for joining us. I hope we'll see you in April and May to continue our Lideramos webinars. We have no questions.